This morning, do a little bit different. I'll read some passages as we get to them. On the back of your bulletin, to take notice of that, it's very important to take notice of this. There are numbers of scriptures listed there. You see in the message note column. This is for your help in your reading, and I hope it'll be a blessing to you. I want to emphasize before we begin today, Mike Schell, you want to write down Tom Schell. His son had a heart attack the other day and was supposed to go home today. They had to work on an artery, but he's doing much better as of yesterday. So you might want to write that down beside Brother Tom's name. Mike Schell was his name. Appreciate that. We continue today with our Ten Commandment study and messages. This is part eight. I'd like Matt to bring up our eighth commandment. Exodus 20:15. Read it with me. Thou shalt not steal. The title of the message, Is There a Robber in the House? Is there a robber in the house? The Sunday school teacher was teaching the children's class one day and wanted to teach the difference between right and wrong. She said, children, I got an example for you. If I were to get into a man's pocket, take out his wallet, and remove his money, what do you think I'd be? Well, a little boy shot his hand up real fast, and teacher asked, well, what would I be? And he gave a little grin and a smile. He said, you'd be his wife. This eighth commandment is given at Mount Sinai. But not only for Israel, it's for us today. And you got to listen carefully. The very foundation of the economic system was built on this verse. We recognize God's given right to work and to earn, to save, to own, have property, to have things, possessions. To take them from another was stealing. It was wrong in the sight of God. In the ancient world, many believed that nothing was wrong as long as you weren't caught. I thought about that. I said, well, that must be happening in 2014 because of a lot of it going on. I don't want an ancient mind. I don't want a pagan mind. I want a godly mind, a wise mind, a Christian mind that follows Jesus. The Bible teaches the Lord does not desire his children to live with pagan minds. We live as people of faith, integrity. We love our neighbor as ourselves. We treat others and their possessions with respect. So let's search this eighth commandment. You'll get three or four words come on the screen today that I think will be a help to you. First of all, we're going to focus on takers. The word is takers. Stealing is taking what doesn't belong to you. You say, well, that's pretty simple. I don't do that. Well, thank God if you don't. But watch the scriptures here for a moment. I want to read some in Joshua 7. Now, you have to read after Jericho, the Battle of Jericho, Joshua 6, and all through 7 to understand the whole passage here, but you'll get the picture. They took it very seriously. In Joshua 7, 19, the Bible said, and Joshua said unto Achan, my son, give, I pray thee, glory to the God of Israel, and make confession unto him, and tell me now what thou hast done, hide it not from me. And Achan answered Joshua and said, indeed, I have sinned against the Lord God of Israel, and thus have I done. When I saw among the spoils a goodly Babylonian garment, 200 shekels of silver and a wedge of gold of 50 shekels weight, then I coveted them and took them. And behold, they are hid in the earth in the midst of my tent and the silver under it. 24. And Joshua and all Israel went with him, took Achan the son of Zerah, the silver and the garment and the wedge of gold, and his sons and his daughters, and his oxen and his asses and his sheep, and his tent and all that he had. They brought them unto the valley of Achor. And Joshua said, why hast thou troubled us? The Lord shall trouble thee this day. And all Israel stoned them with stones and burned them with fire after they had stoned them with the stones. I'd say today that somebody got a real clear message about stealing. After the Battle of Jericho, the tribes of Israel dedicated what was called accursed things, A-C-C-U-R-S-E-D. It means special possessions dedicated to God. They weren't to take the booty or the possessions from the land of Jericho. They were put them as special possessions for the Lord's work. Wake and his crowd, they stole some. God showed them how much stealing cost. Took his family and all of his possessions down to the Valley of Achor, and they stoned them and burned them. Over in the New Testament, as we look further, the story of the Good Samaritan. You remember the story of the Good Samaritan? A certain man went on the road down to Jericho. He said he fell among the thieves, the robbers. They beat him, left him half dead, took all of his money and possessions. They were just present day what we call thugs, robbers. What you have is mine and I'll take it. That was their picture. And you'll find it throughout America and around the world today. Same idea is carried through many peoples throughout our world. I found an article about shoplifting in the United States. You haven't shoplifted lately, have you? U.S. Department of Commerce said 4 million people were caught shoplifting each year. The shock for me was this. 10% were called low income. 70% who shoplifted were middle income. 20% were wealthy. You ever had something stolen from you? Purse, billfold, money, credit cards, bicycle, cars, home broken into? Had a pastor friend in the 90s say that's one of the most humiliating things for having his house broken into. Things thrown aside. They lost a few things, but not many. But it's just great shame. A violation. Consider that you may have stolen, taken things. When you're a child, you take candy from the drawer that you're supposed to eat. What about money from your mom's pocketbook or from your dad's billfold? What about when you go to the store and the cashier gives you back some cash, if you use cash today? Some people don't use cash anymore. You give it back and they said, that looks real good. And you know good and well it's too much. Stick it in your pocket. Do you give it back? Copying music. Dave's real, very much interested in those who do that. And it should be. They don't check with the publisher. And they just make all kinds of copies. Maybe some people go out and sell them. It's stealing. You borrowed your friend's books and tools lately, never returned them, kept them as your own. We need to be convicted by God's eighth commandment, don't we? There are those things that don't belong to you. If you take it, you need to return it. If it's not returnable, you buy it new and replace it. You've got to make a commitment to do that. It takes serious acting. It takes a humble heart, I think, a sorrowful heart. Ask for God's forgiveness. See, because if you are a Christian walking in the ways of Christ, you got to have a heart for Christ, love for Christ. You want to do what is right in His sight. The Word of God compels us. Now, if you go back and tell them that you love the Lord and you're sorry that you've taken this and you want to return it, they might have a slight heart attack, but anyway, it might help you. See, sometimes people don't need just to hear about your faith. They need to see it. Living action. Not just words, but action. The Bible has an answer for the takers today. You bring this up, Matt, Ephesians 4 and 28. Everybody see that? Say it with me, church. You watch the screen. Let him that stole steal no more, but rather let him labor, working with his hands the thing which is good, that he may have to give to him that needeth. It's a great verse, isn't it? Brother Paul had that in Ephesus. He's trying to teach the Christians about that. Takers, stop robbing or stealing. Start working. Give you honest living. And I know today that there are those who try to find jobs. They can't find good jobs or the right kind of job. And things don't work out, but you still be honest in your dealings. You seek the Lord's guidance and wisdom. Don't just go take things. Ask for help. Don't be ashamed. We work to glorify God, and He allows us to help our family and our fellow man and even others in need. So first of all, the word is what? Takers. If you steal, you're a taker. Secondly, today, those who steal, we can call them cheaters or deceivers. Cheaters or deceivers. Let's look into the scripture here. We go to the Old Testament prophet Amos. Amos was a farmer, farm preacher who came back to town. God used him to speak to the people of Israel. Listen to these words, Amos chapter 7. Hear this, O ye that swallow up the needy, even to make the poor of the land to fail. Saying, when will the new moon be gone that we may sell corn, and the Sabbath that we may set forth wheat, making the ephah small and the shekel great, and falsifying the balances by deceit, that we may buy the poor for silver, the needy for a pair of shoes, yea, and sell the refuge of the wheat. The Lord hath sworn by the excellency of Jacob, surely I will never forget any of their works. The Lord was serious. He sent the prophet Amos. They were appalled at the money-making schemes, overcharging the people, setting the scales in a different way. Verse 5 said they couldn't wait till the Sabbath was over and other special days so they could trap the poor. Proverbs 20 and 23 talks about the Lord hates dishonest scales and weights. That was 3,500 years ago. Let's bring it up to the 21st century. It's even found that service stations today, sometimes you don't pay for a gallon of gas. They might have it at 7.75 or 8.75 or 9.1 or 9/10, I say, of the gallon, you see. What about deceit at the hands of a mechanic or repairs on your house? May not need to be. They charge exuberant prices. Deceitful salesmen making false claims. This is all part of the cheating and deceiving of today. Deception is a sophisticated way of stealing to obtain someone else's money or property. Look at the hackers today into our banking systems. Credit card companies. It's all a violation of the Eighth Commandment. Over in the New Testament, it's a great story in Luke chapter 19. His name was Zacchaeus. Remember Zacchaeus? Zacchaeus, a wee little man. Not only was a wee little man, he was a rich, stingy, deceitful, cheating man. He was a tax man, publican. Not only did he steal for Romans, he stole for himself. But one day he said, I heard about Jesus. I want to find out about this Jesus. He's a very interesting man. So he said he climbed up into the sycamore tree and some branch, and surely he could see over the people. There came Jesus. Jesus said, Zacchaeus, you stingy, cheating rascal, get down from that tree. Is that what he told him? He said, Zacchaeus, you're the sorriest, iriest man I've ever seen in the history of Rome. You stole them from your own people. You stole them from us, your friends. No, he didn't say that. He said, Zach, come on down, buddy. I'm going to your house today. Zacchaeus said he came down, went to his house. Well, what happened? I'll tell you what happened. He was saved. He was changed, transformed, changed his mind and his heart, put him on a new direction. And his household also. Listen here in Luke's gospel. It said in verse 8, as Zacchaeus stood and said to the Lord, behold, Lord, the half of my goods I give to the poor. And if I've taken anything from any man by false accusation, that's stealing, I restore him fourfold, four times over. Jesus said, today salvation's come to this house. Think with me for a moment. If God could do that for Zacchaeus, he can do it for you or me. I'm sure if Christ, if you could have been sitting there in that room with him, he pointed him to the good news that he could receive eternal life, a mind change, a heart change, and it changes daily life. Why is it when people come to Jesus, they can live like they always wanted to live? There's not any repentance, not any turning from their sin. Isn't that what repentance is? God calls one to turn from your sin and your selfish ways and turn to Christ by the way of the cross. So the problem with Zacchaeus was stealing. Not only his spiritual heart was changed, his outward life was changed. He made what needs to be happening today with robbers. It's called restitution, repaying. If you take it, repay it back. That's what you do. Restore it. Did you hear the man who cheated on his taxes? He had a very guilty conscience. So he got out his checkbook and he wrote the IRS a $500 bill, $500 check. Enclosed, he wrote this note. I underpaid taxes last year and I'm feeling real guilty. Please accept my enclosed payment that I owe you. And if I don't feel any better about this, I'll send the rest that I owe you. I wonder what happened to that guy. God commands not to steal. Cheaters, deceivers, not to be found among his children. You remember the life of Zacchaeus today. Restitution, repayment. Now, thirdly, today we want to talk about stealing as defraud. Defrauders. You know what defrauding is? To withhold what rightfully belongs to another. We do that with people. We do it in families. We do it in workplaces. But I want us today to focus on several things about our relationship to God. Violating our relationship to God. Now, first of all, we want to talk about stealing or defrauding our Lord with our possessions. Now, look in Malachi. This is Old Testament. The prophet Malachi is talking to his people. God led him to do that. He said, something's wrong here, friends. He's talking about the sins of the people returning to the Lord. In verse 8, Malachi 3:8, he says, will a man rob God? Yet ye have robbed me. But you say, wherein have we robbed thee? In tithes and offerings. You're cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me, even this whole nation. Bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in mine house. Prove me now, herewith saith the Lord of hosts, if I will not open you the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive it. The prophet was sent to preach to the people. They've been robbing God. He said, Brother Malachi, what are you talking about? He said, you know you've kept back your tithes and offerings. Well, what do the tithes and offerings belong to? They belong to the Lord, your God. Look, the whole nation is under judgment. The Lord said, I challenge you and I promise you, you bring your tithes in, I pour out the blessings. Steve Wingfield, in his devotional book, Winning the Race Every Day, he told about the story of giving taught by his dad. He said, walking down the street one day, and a man said, sir, I don't have any coins. I'd like a cup of coffee. So little Steve was a very small boy then, and he looked up at his dad, and daddy said, hold on, son, we're going to this little shop. He brought the man in. Opened his little purse. You know, he used to have little coin purse things. And he took out and shook it out, and two little dimes fell out. Gave it to the man, said, please give him a cup of coffee. So they said, bye. Out the door they went. Down the street, and lo and behold, he said, my daddy reached over and picked up a dollar bill off the street. He said, son, I want to tell you something. Here's a real picture. Always remember it. You can never outgive God. He's going to show up in your life. You be faithful to Him. He said, I never forgot that. Never. Jesus said in Luke 6 and 38, Matt, can you bring that up for us? I want us to read this beautiful verse. This is Jesus speaking. Give, and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, shall men give into your bosom. For with the same measure that you meet withal, it shall be measured unto you again. How's your measure of your giving? How can we defraud our Lord, who's given everything to us? All you are, all you have, He's given it. You believe that? How can you be here today? He's given you life, the physical life, to be sitting here today in this glorious house of worship. What about eternal life? He's a salvation giver. Salvation, the gift of God. He's given it. The marvelous grace poured out in His Son. Gave Him on the cross. Shed His own blood. Died for our sins. Buried. Rose again. Lives. He's coming back. He's given us that. He's a peace giver. Hope giver. Comfort giver. The ability in your mind to work, to earn a living, to enjoy it. There's nothing wrong with having money. There's nothing wrong with having things. But do things have you? That's the question. And how are you using your possessions to honor God? Are we defrauding? Are we withholding? How is it that a person can go to the restaurant? Sometimes now the gratuity thing on the sheets, what they run, 15% and up. But you let somebody give a tithe, give a tenth. They say, whoa, give a tenth to God? That church doesn't need that. I'm not giving that pastor any money. You got the wrong picture, friends. It's for the glory of God and His kingdom's work. We spend so much on ourselves. You think about it. This week is a great challenge for all of us. Look around at your possessions. Doesn't matter what you have, house, car, televisions, whatever it is, furniture, it doesn't matter. I want you to look around all things that you possess. God's given you all these things. And ask yourself this question. How am I giving to God what belongs to Him? I did not say anything was wrong with having things. That's not the question. God has blessed us with that. How is our giving back to God? Secondly, today in this relationship to God, did you know that we can steal our relationship with God in time? You with me? You said, now, preacher, you're starting to meddle. You're just starting to meddle now. I give God an hour on Sunday. Some say, well, I give Him 2 hours on Sunday. Some say, well, gosh, I give God 3 hours. I'm not talking about just the house of God. I'm not talking about just coming to the house of God. I'm talking about in 24 hours of your day. Everybody's given 24 hours. Is that not true? That's called your time given to you by God. All of us have it. What are we doing daily in our relationship to God? Think with me for a moment. You've heard the word quiet time. People use different words. Call it Bible time. Your personal worship time. What do you do with your Bible? People say, preacher, I want to know about the will of God. Well, when have you read it? When have you read His letter? Doesn't He teach us in His word about His will and His ways, His plan? So many today running out into the world, doing this, doing that, doing the work, and are fine people. I'm not saying they're not fine people. But we're stealing time from God. Teach us to number our days, apply our hearts unto wisdom, Psalm 19:12. Ephesians 5, 15 through 17 talks about redeeming the time. Make the most of our time. Why? The days are evil. Walk wisely. Live wisely. Use your time wisely to know what the will of God is. Your prayer time. Do you praise God? Let me give you a challenge this week. It's called ACTS. All right? Are you with me? A is a door. Praise. Praise to God for who He is, how great He is. Open the Bible and you'll find all kinds of praises, like in the Psalms. Faithful God, merciful God, gracious God, loving God. You see what I'm saying? Why don't you just spend one day about praising God? Just take time, lunchtime, before you eat a bite, praise Him. Second day, see, confess. Oh, you don't have any sins to confess. I know. We don't ever do anything wrong, do we? We don't think wrong. We don't talk wrong. No, we don't do anything like that, do we? How about what's hidden in our heart? Ain't nothing wrong with us, is it? Spend a day, just different times. Thanks. T. A-C-T. Do you give thanks to the Lord when you get up in the morning? Thank you, Lord, that I am able to get up this morning. Thank you for my food, my family. Supplication. S. A-C-T-S. Supply our needs. We have needs. Family needs, concerns. Worship time. It's even personal, family time, your devotional time sometimes with family. Public times here, coming together in the house of God. Now, this is a whole message in itself, but I just want to touch base here. We steal from God in our talents. I like to talk about the gifts of the Spirit for the Christian, but talents and natural abilities, sing, play, read, these kinds of things. Then teaching, preaching, ministering, giving, all those are under spiritual gifts for the Christian. God's Holy Spirit gives the Christian spiritual gifts. That's a whole big new, several messages. You ever thought how many people in this congregation today are not giving themselves to the Lord? We withhold it. We're like defrauding our talents and our gifts to God. Ask Him. Lord, what is it that you want me to do in your service, in my life, to honor you? He'll show you. He'll bless your life. Let's help with something about stealing in life. As a Christian, if you love Jesus Christ, I want to ask you this question. Is Jesus Lord of your life? Now, you think of that. You say, oh, I know Jesus is my personal Savior. I trust the way of the cross and believe in the resurrection. I know I'm going to heaven. Is Jesus Lord of all of your life? All of it. Time, talents, treasures, whatever it is. Is He the director of my life? That's a real question. We have to answer that. Talkers and takers. Cheaters or deceivers. Defrauders. Search your heart right now and ask God, do I have a problem in stealing? Let's bow our heads for our invitation. Father God, thank you for this day, thank you for this great commandment, the eighth commandment of the Ten Commandments. Lord, I pray you've searched our hearts today and gone deep in our souls. By your Holy Spirit, would you convict us right now if there's any kind of stealing going on in our life? Lord, we look at others. Help us right now to search our own heart and see where we stand with you. Maybe there's someone here today outside of Jesus Christ and needs the Savior, the Lord Jesus. I pray they confess their sins to him. Come humbly to the cross. Say, Lord Jesus, I need you. I'm separated from you. I'm lost. But I know that you can save me and change me. Give me a new mind and a new heart and a new life. Come into my life and change me. Maybe, Father, today there's one here who needs to come into the church, a couple, a family, and begin to serve Jesus Christ as part of your church family. And for many here today, Lord, search us personally to see where we stand with you. We ask this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.